So I'll tell you a snippet from lecture material in CNO 255, which is Introduction to Optimization, but the advanced section. So we are in the middle of the term, really. So what happened is that I covered some results last time, and this lecture, we're going to use those results to conclude something else. So when that's the situation, I usually make sure that I arrive in the classroom at least, say, 3-4 minutes earlier than the start time of the class, and then I start writing down something that I'll recall from the previous lectures. So now this is me arriving 4 minutes early. Of course. So even though I don't talk very much on those during those four minutes, you know, if somebody wants to engage me, I'm happily engageable. All right, so let me finish writing this. Good morning, everyone. So last time we covered this theorem and its proof, and it was a beautiful theorem that gave us some very nice certificate of unsolvability of systems of linear inequalities. So if you remember my notation, every vector is going to be a column vector. So here for this theorem, I've got a matrix A that's m by n, and the vector B, that's a column vector that has m entries. And the theorem says that for any pair of A and B, exactly one of the following holds. So either that you have a solution to this system of linear inequalities, and I think that one of you missed this lecture, notice that the inequality notation between vectors is component-wise. So this means that the first entry of that vector is less than or equal to first entry of this vector, and the second entry of this is less than or equal to second entry of that, and so on. Okay? So either a system of linear inequalities has a solution, or another system has a solution. Okay? So if this system is unsolvable, then there exists another vector y, so that A transpose y is the zero vector. Again, remember my notation, sometimes zero is a scalar, sometimes it's a vector of zeros, depending on the context. Since the left-hand side is a vector, this is also a vector, right? A transpose y is equal to 0, y is non-negative, so every component of y is non-negative, and B transpose y is strictly less than 0, okay? So this is really quite beautiful because it tells you that if a system is solvable, then you simply give a solution, and somebody can verify that that's indeed so. And if a system is unsolvable, this theorem tells you that the situation is essentially the same. You give some other solution to an alternative system, and its verification is equally easy. Okay, so we would like to sharpen this understanding a little bit more and give an application to convex geometry. So let's look at this a little bit more carefully and help us recall some of the things. So I'm just going to draw this picture. So this is my system AX less than or equal to B, right? So I'm going to think of these Ys as multipliers for the inequalities. So notice that if these Ys exist, then there's going to be m of them. They're going to be non-negative. And I can take, say, the first inequality and multiply both sides by y1 and maintain it. Right? Okay, so then let me do that for each inequality, and then let me just add up the result. So if I'm in the second case, then there exists such a y. So let me just write it here. If ax less than or equal to b has no solution, then I'll have these y's, and I'm looking at them as coefficients of these inequalities, and I'm going to multiply both sides by the corresponding yi's and add them up. Then notice that on the left-hand side, A transpose y is equal to the zero vector, so on the left-hand side, I'm going to get y transpose A as a row vector. So it's the row vector that's the zero vector. So this is going to be 0, 0, 0, right? And x, I have a linear function. And then, since I multiplied both sides by non-negative coefficients, and then I kept the inequalities in the same direction, I'll have this inequality. And on the right-hand side, I'm going to end up with b transpose y, right? Summation of bi yi. And in this case, since the system is unsolvable, the theorem tells me that b transpose y will be strictly less than 0 for that choice of y. But notice that on the left-hand side, it doesn't matter what x is. Inner product of x with the 0 vector is 0. So there's an obvious contradiction, right? So it tells you that the system ax less than or equal to b is unsolvable, right? So we assume that it had no solution, and I'm just showing you how these y's illustrate that unsolvability. Okay? And this is the beautiful thing about systems of linear inequalities. Okay, so I would like to look into these certificates, y, of unsolvability, and I would like to sharpen them a little bit more. So whenever a system is unsolvable, then we can find these y's, and they'll tell us in this way that the system is unsolvable, but can I sort of get into it in some more detail? So can I really point out where the problem really is? Okay. So what do I mean by this is, can I have more sort of compact certificates y? So let's think about that a bit. So what can I say? I should have prepared, that would have helped. But let me start with some system that's obviously unsolvable. So let me just make it up as I go along. So notice that each linear inequality describes geometrically a closed half space. So if I pick a line on R2, and then if I take, say, one side of it, this describes the set of solutions to a single linear inequality. Right? Okay, so let me take another line that's parallel to the first one that I drew. Okay? And then let me choose my inequality so that the upper part of it is where my solutions are. So if I've got two linear inequalities like this, clearly they don't have a common solution, so the underlying system would be unsolvable. Right? So now let me try to do it algebraically. So for instance, if the first one is, say, let me write the first one here, maybe the first one is something like summation xj is less than or equal to 1, j running from 1 to n. I mean, this was in R2, but the picture worked out, so I feel confident I'm going to do it in full generality, right? I have some inequality like this. And then this one is something like summation j running from 1 to n negative xj is less than or equal to negative 2, right? I mean, this one says x is sum up to at most 1. This one says x is sum up to at least 2. So those two clearly contradict each other, right? And this system is, so I'm just thinking of this. So this system is clearly infeasible, right? And if you look at the theorem, so I've got some A and I've got some B for which one does not hold. The theorem tells me that two must hold. So it tells me that there must exist some coefficients that are non-negative that do this. And that's pretty clear, I think, because I choose the coefficient y1 equals 1 for this and y2 equals 1 for that. They are clearly non-negative numbers. Multiply both sides, add them up. On the left-hand side, these sums will cancel. And on the right-hand side, I'll end up with b transpose y, which is minus 1 in this case. So in this case, you see that you have got sort of a small system of linear inequalities. This could be a part of a very big system, and that system would be infeasible because it's impossible to satisfy this subsystem. Right? So clearly, two inequalities could cause infeasibility, and it would be nice to hone in on them if you can hone in on them. So it can happen with two inequalities, but of course, we already knew something from here. It could even happen with a single inequality, right? If you choose your inequality so that the coefficients are all zeros, and you choose as your right-hand side a negative number, you just manage to write an infeasible inequality, right? Something like 0 less than or equal to minus 1, right? Okay, but what are the sort of minimal systems in the worst case? So what I mean is that if such a thing exists in my system, then fine. But if my system is infeasible, does such a thing always have to exist? So if you think about it in that way, you realize that, well, this is a very special infeasible linear inequality system. And so is this, because these guys are parallel to each other. So if I were to sort of pick randomly my closed half spaces, neither of those two would really happen, right? So maybe I need another picture. So let me try to think what I can do a little bit more generally. So let me pick some, again in R2, some lines that are not so special, right? So for instance, for this line, let me take this part as the closed half space I want. And then for this line, let me pick this side as the closed half space that I want. Notice that I want to solve a system of linear inequalities. And if I want to satisfy this one and that one, then I must be inside that wedge, right? Okay, so how about I take this line and describe this side of it as the requirement for satisfying my linear inequality system. So notice that this system that I described to you geometrically is infeasible, right? Because this region does not intersect with that. Okay, but notice that if I remove any one of the inequalities, it does become feasible. Okay, so maybe I can try to generalize that. So can I do that algebraically? Can I do that algebraically? In general, of course. We don't want to just stay in R2. So let me describe my A matrix. I'm going to take minus identity, x, and then I'm going to take zeros, and then I'm going to take minus 1. So this is going to be my A. Notice that this A is going to be, I'm going to do it in Rn, so it's going to be n plus 1 by n. And this is my B. And my B is in Rn plus 1. And I want you to think about this system where, you know, the first part just tells me that my vector x must be non-negative. And the last inequality tells me that they must add up to, at most, minus 1. Right? So basically, I got this idea by looking at this picture. This seemed like the non-negative Orton to me, right? Okay. So this part seemed to be the non-negative Orton, and I seemed like I was taking its complement, right? So that's how I got minus x less than or equal to 0, and this is the complement of that one. So notice that the system that I wrote there is clearly infeasible. Right? You cannot find n non-negative numbers that add up to at most minus 1. Right? And in terms of our theorem, actually, the proof given by y vector, again, we can take all the y values to be 1. Right? If you just add up all the rows here, you end up with the 0 row. You add up all the elements here, you end up with minus 1. Clear contradiction. But notice that every proper subsystem has a solution. So every proper subsystem, I mean, if you remove any one of the inequalities or any subset of the inequalities, you end up with a system that has a solution. And you probably need to do something between now and the next lecture. And I want you to consider the vector 0 minus e1 minus e2 minus en, where minus ei denotes the ith unit vector. So if you remove any one of these vectors will be feasible. In particular, if you remove the last one, 0 is a feasible solution. If you remove the first one from here, you allow x1 to take any value, then you can set x1 to minus 1, everybody to 0, and you'll satisfy it. So now it shows you that if you try to find a y that's sort of more concise than having m entries, the best you can hope for is n plus 1, right? So this is a system that's infeasible, and to certify it, like this theorem says, I really have to look at a subsystem of a big system that has size at least n plus 1. So if we had half an hour more, we would prove the theorem of Helly's from 1913 that says that this is really the worst case. In fact, for any given system of linear inequalities, if it turns out to be infeasible, you can always find a subsystem of the system of inequalities of size at most n plus 1, just one more than the number of variables, so that subsystem is infeasible. Okay? And it's going to be a consequence of this theorem and some refinement of the underlying solution y. Thank you for your attention.